We're going to start worship by singing two songs, How Great is Our God, and our second song, The River, will be introduced by Ed Van de Winkle for a few bars, and then when the praise team joins in, feel free to join in along with them.
Thunder of the King.
I think that Ed deserves a round of applause. Thank you. Great job. Thank you, Ed. God has blessed us in so many ways. Let's return now our blessings to God.
When you go by, let's help ourselves.
And minds to you this morning, that you help us to appreciate that you are present with us in this space and everywhere we are. And we pray that as you do so, as you let your spirit flow through us, that you not only inform us, but you also comfort us, that you help ease those burdens that are distracting us, those things that are carrying our minds away from you, those issues within society and within our own lives that are somehow a threat to us. And God, as we do so, we recognize that we have not always been pure and holy in your sight, that we have not honorably reflected the image in which you made us. And so we seek your forgiveness now, God. In the privacy of our own silent confession, we offer you those things that distress us. Loving God, you have heard our confession, and we pray for your forgiveness. And as we pray for your forgiveness, we also ask for your help in forgiving others, those who have hurt us, those who have spoken an unkind word, those who somehow have slighted us. And we pray that as we forgive them, you also open our hearts to the mercy and kindness with which we were forgiven. That you help us to be as Jesus in everything we do, say, and are, and that as we come to you in this hour, you help us to be forgiven, to feel safe, and also to offer a place of safety and comfort to those around us. We give you these words in Jesus' name, and we say together, Amen. And I think Sandy is our scripture reader this morning.
Our first reading is from Matthew chapter 6, verse 13. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. Therefore, put on the full armor of God, so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground, and after you have done everything, to stand. Stand firm, then, with the belt of truth buckled about your waist, with the breastplate of righteousness in place, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. In addition to all this, take up the shield of faith, with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, and pray in the Spirit on all occasions, with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the Lord's people.
You recognize Harold Lloyd? Harold Lloyd was a silent film and early into the talkies, but he was a silent film star. And this picture of him hanging from a clock was in his movie called Safety Last. There is no net. There is no rope. Now, the clock is actually a prop. It was hung off the building. It is, however, some 60 feet in the air. And to mark just how strong this man is, When he filmed this movie, he only had 8 fingers. One of his previous stunts in an earlier film involved a small explosive, and the small explosive removed the second and baby finger off one of his hands, and so he wore a prosthetic glove to hide it. But here he was hanging from only 8 fingers, 60 feet or more in the air, no net, no rope, no safety gear. Now imagine a film set allowing that to happen today. However, while we have safety practices in place, none of you would think of driving away in your car with a seatbelt off nowadays, right? And when you go to work, if you are in a shop, you're often required to wear safety glasses, ear protection, safety boots. If there's anything at all going on overhead, you're required to wear a helmet as well. Gloves. You don't do anything without taking care, without trying to stay safe. Even in our homes, how many of you have prescription medicines that you have to start 5 minutes before due time in order to get them open? Because of the so-called safety caps, right? Well, some people think safety is vastly overrated, and I would like to show you this little film clip of a few situations where the Workmen's Compensation Board will probably be called shortly. Try clicking right on it, Pete. Well, okay. Be that way. Okay. Stand aside. It says 25 pieces of evidence why women live longer than men. And it features such exciting stuff. So, not everybody takes safety seriously, right? However, we as people of faith, believe it or not, pray for our safety. Sandy shared the reading from the Lord's Prayer that says, "Lead us not into temptation and deliver us from evil." Safety passages. We don't want to get into trouble, and we don't want trouble to get to us. That's basically what it's saying. We're asking that God directs and deliver us from these struggles. Now, these two lines raise an interesting question. Lead us not into temptation. Does that mean that God is active in leading us into temptation? Deliver us from evil? Does that mean that God plops us into the midst of evil? Are we laying blame at God's feet when we ask this prayer? Well, if you remember, and if you don't, I'll refresh your memory. The prayer starts out by saying, "Our Father in heaven." So we start by making a statement of who's in charge. And we say, "Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven." So we not only state who's in charge, we say we'd like to be doing what you're doing. We want to line up with your will. And then we ask for our daily provision, our daily bread, our daily nurturing spiritually and physically. We ask for forgiveness and that we forgive. The pattern is one of dependence. The pattern that Jesus establishes is one of dependence. We want God's kingdom, so we depend on God helping us to bring that kingdom about. We need God to do our feeding spiritually and physically. We need God to forgive us. So it's a prayer of dependence. So when we get to the part that says, "Lead us not into temptation," we're not saying that God picks us up and puts us into the face of that great chocolate cake in the midst of our diet. What we're doing is we're saying, we need your help. It's a dependent prayer. Lead us. You be the one to help us, to keep us away from that. And how is God going to lead us? But with what we've already asked for. God leads us because we have already asked him if we can do his will, to bring his kingdom in heaven about on earth. We depend on him for our nurturing. So our daily bread is not just the food that we eat every day, but it's also the intelligence and wisdom, the spiritual maturity to know the difference between right and wrong. And if we do blow it, we've asked for forgiveness, just as we forgive others. So when we ask God to lead us not into temptation, to find us a different path, we've already expressed the reality that we are on course as long as we maintain our integrity, as long as we stay true to the prayer. The lead us not into temptation isn't so much a request as it is a statement of need and an expression of what is happening. You can almost read it as, "God, you lead us away from temptation. Because you provide for us, because we're doing your will." And then when we ask God to deliver us from evil, well then, what we're saying is, if we get into trouble, give us a step up. Give us a way out. Sometimes that way out is literal deliverance. So God will help us, God will give us the strength or the wisdom to solve a problem. And sometimes that deliverance is in those middle two lines about forgiveness. Sometimes our only deliverance from evil is being forgiven for what we've done, or being able to forgive others. So when we ask God to direct us away from our temptation, when we ask God to deliver us from evil, we're doing so equipped, ready, prepared. God has given us the gifts. In Jesus' prayer, we seek out those gifts. And so when we come to trouble, we know we're ready to deal with it. Whether it's having the wisdom to stay away from that chocolate cake because we know it's going to ruin our diet and make our doctor very disappointed, and heaven knows an introvert doesn't want to disappoint anybody. Or simply to say, oh, we've gotten ourselves into real big trouble here. I need forgiveness. Now this idea, this prayer, this idea of coming to God with our needs, this is a generality, isn't it? But God provides us even more direction in our prayer and where to seek help. So this is a general few ideas. I mean, it's a very short prayer, but then there's Paul. Jesus gives us the direction. Paul starts to fill in the picture. Paul is teaching the early Christians how to live, what it means to be a follower of Christ. So if you put the next slide up, please. He starts by giving us, or in the letter to the Ephesians, he gives us a series of tools. He calls it armor. He's speaking about ways to gird ourselves against the world, ways to protect ourselves, ways to stay safe. So he gives us truth. Just keep going here. Righteousness. He gives us readiness. He gives us faith. He gives us God's word. Those are the essential elements. We don't need to worry about if it's a breastplate or a buckler or a shield or a belt or shoes. Those are the key words in Paul's letter to the Ephesians. This is what we need in order to be safe, to be protected, to live fully. Next slide, please. But Paul then does something interesting. Here's why he tells us. He says, our struggle is not against flesh and blood. And here's what we have to keep in mind as people of faith. When Paul tells us our struggle is not against flesh and blood, what he's saying is that we aren't worried what happens to our bodies. From a spiritual perspective, as Christians, it's not that our bodies don't matter. Certainly they are the vessels that carry our soul. They are God's physical expression and manifestation. They are the way that we live and express God's love. But our body's safety is secondary to the health and well-being of our souls. Our struggle is not against flesh and blood, next point, but against the rulers. Go on. Against the authorities. Keep going. Against the powers of this dark world. And against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realm. So you see what we've got here. This is our true struggle. When we're saying deliver us from evil in the Lord's Prayer, this is what we're talking about. Against the rulers, against those politicians or people in power who would either distract us from the truth or make us do things that we know aren't healthy. Against the authorities, against people who impose their power on us. Against the powers of this dark world. Hatred, fear, malice, spite, selfishness, greed, lust. And against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Now there's a powerful phrase, the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Do you ever think that angels might go astray? Well, that's the suggestion here, isn't it? That there is evil even in the heavens. And how do we identify that heavenly evil? A guy named Satan, right? We use that word. So there's an overwhelming force of evil in the world as well. So Paul equips us to deal with these things with this image of armor, the full armor of God, with this militaristic image. Let's take it apart then for a minute. Let's look at the first one, truth. Oh, what is truth? Truth is knowledge. Just keep going on. Truth is who and what God is about. Truth is knowing ourselves. Truth is knowing right from wrong. And this is where we begin to resist against those powers, against the authorities, against the principalities, even against ourselves. We have righteousness. What is righteousness? Well, righteousness is not just knowing right from wrong, but it's doing the right thing. It's standing up when a bully is speaking out. It's being able to resist temptation. Little head, but it's okay. But we know what righteousness is because it's doing God's will. It's putting ourselves second and putting God first and doing what God wants. And that is doing the right thing. Now you can go to this one. And it's living kingdom-worthy lives. Living not in expectation of the kingdom, not as if it's someplace far off in the distance, but as if it's already here. Living up as if we are in God's kingdom, embraced by God, surviving with and for God. The next one, we go on to, should be another one. See what happens next. Okay. Go on, yeah, we did that one. Is there another one after it? Okay. There we go. Thank you. So, readiness. You know the old Boy Scout saying, Lord Baden-Powell, be prepared? Well, how do we stay ready? Well, let's go to first point. This might seem obvious, right? Being alert and conscious. And what do I mean by that? Well, it means paying attention. It's not just a question of living and coasting through life, but it's being alert and conscious to the needs around us, to what God's will is for our lives, to where we're going astray, to where people need us, to the places where we can make a difference, to what our church is doing, what we are doing. Next point. Readiness means having the truth at our disposal. It means not only knowing it in our head. Somebody described the difference between knowing and understanding once as having the facts and using the facts. So knowing, right, we can have the truth. We can have all the truth we want. We can have books full of it. We can have a head full of great sayings. But to understand it means to actually use it. So to have it at our disposal, to be ready to act upon it. And the next point, Peter. Looking for opportunities actively. Not just being alert and conscious, but also going out and saying, okay, where can I help? What can I do? Putting your hand out and saying, I'd like to help, as opposed to, do you need a hand? To the guy in the burning car. Talking about safety. And that, did you see the accident near Windsor where a pickup truck crossed the center line and managed to hit three cars, and the pickup truck was virtually destroyed? There were only minor injuries of it. But if you get a chance to look up that video, take a look. The guy who owns the store with the camera that filmed it was the son of a firefighter, and he ran out immediately. And what he had learned from his father served to help those victims in the car. He checked the truck that it was destroyed because it was the most damaged vehicle. He went on and he helped a passenger out of another vehicle. When that first truck caught fire, he brought a fire extinguisher out and put the fire out. You know, there's somebody who's ready. There's somebody who was prepared, who knew what to do. So that's the readiness. The next point, please. Faith. This isn't just about knowledge here. It's also about trust, right? Trusting God, believing in God. It's believing that God will make a difference, that there's a point, that this is worth doing. Go on, please. Trust. Confidence.
not just lip service, but actually turning that belief into those kinds of work. So imagine, let's go back to this guy who helped out the victims of this accident. You know, imagine if he didn't trust himself and he said, well, you know, I might hurt somebody, or I might not use my extinguisher properly, or I might get into trouble. Now, he had the confidence to go out and to use those skills boldly and without fear. Let's go to the final point, God's Word. This is where it all stems from, right? So we need scriptural understanding, right? We need to understand our Bible. We need to read through it carefully. We also need support workers in terms of books, in terms of resources and tools, right? Reading material that helps us interpret and understand the scripture, helps us apply it to our daily lives, helps us to take a book that's thousands of years old and speak to us today, but also to seek a mentor's help, to reach out to somebody who's got a little experience in life. They don't even need to be older. And sometimes a mentor is a child who shows us how to live joyfully. Sometimes a mentor is a student who reminds us of what it is to learn, of the blessing of soaking up information. So these are the tools that Paul gives us. Then he ends up in an interesting place. Look where he goes. Next point, please. Then he says, pray in the Spirit on all occasions. Always pray for all the Lord's people. And parenthetically, he says, pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. And then he says, always pray for all the Lord's people. And then I add it again, with all kinds of prayers and requests. So here, Paul takes us back to what it is that connects us to God, how it is possible for us to have the truth, the righteousness, the readiness, the faith, God's word, is by prayer. And Jesus gives us that simple prayer that we have been studying for the last little while. And ultimately, it ends up to be a prayer of protection, of safety. Direct and deliver us. We can turn it around. It says, lead us not into temptation. Or we can ask God, take us to those places you want us to be. Take us to those places of service. Take us to those places of love. Take us to those places of healing, of comfort, of joy. Take us to your places of truth, of righteousness, of readiness, of faith. Take us to your word. And when we get into trouble, help us use those tools you've given us. When evil overwhelms us, help us to use those tools to understand what's going on. I don't know if any of you have been following politics at all ever throughout your lives. Anybody ever hear of an election here in Canada? There's something happening in the States as well. So we're trying to work our way through our minefield of all these different voices of people speaking, and some folks saying intelligent things, some folks saying silly things, and parties fighting with one another, and parties fighting within themselves. And I don't know if you're on Facebook, but Facebook is great for arguments, discussions, and general exchanges of opinion. But out of all of this, out of this political melee here in Canada and in the States, what we have to do is not worry about the banter. We have to worry about what God's will is through all of this. So we have to try to sift through and find the truth. What is the party and the policy that will best honor God? How is it that we can be faithful in our voting so that it's not about the party or the person, but about our nation? About turning those principalities into something that serve God? So we need prayer in those issues. We need to pray for those more torn places in the world. We see Syria continues to be in the news. And now Iraq is creating new refugees. The refugee story in Afghanistan is ongoing and continuing. You can call it a refugee crisis in Mexico, again, with so many folks trying to escape there to find decent lives in the States. So we have these issues that are coming to mind, and our response to them must start with prayer. And then we can go from there to the practical aspects, to looking for opportunities to help, to actively reaching out and using our gifts and skills. And out of all of this, if we have God's will, if we let God provide for us, if we make room for forgiveness from God and from us, then God will direct us to where He needs us and will protect us so that we can do what's right, so that we can bring about His kingdom and live it now. Are you ready to pray? Let's bow our heads together. Father in heaven, Abba, Daddy, Creator, Wisdom, Almighty, All-Knowing, All-Loving, we come before You as Your children, as sheep. We come before You as brothers and sisters. We come before You as servants, as models, as beings made in Your image. We place ourselves at Your feet, recognizing that You are beyond our human dimensions and understanding, that You are cosmic and universal, and yet through us, through our feelings, our minds, our actions, You express Yourself here on earth in a way that we can understand, in a way that reflects the Son that You sent. So we pray, God, that we not only reflect You in our bodies, but also in our wills, that we do what it is You call us to do, that You love us, and that we in turn love You. And we ask that You help us, that You provide those daily needs for us, both spiritually and physically. And we only ask for enough. Enough for us to be fed or clothed, and maybe a little extra so that we can share what we have, so that we can also be a source of provision for others, so that we can nourish the hungry and clothe the naked, so that we can turn our friendship with You into friendship for the stranger. And God, when we blow it, we seek Your forgiveness, but more importantly, we ask that You help us to forgive truly and faithfully. And God, direct us where You need us to be. Teach us the truths we need so that when there are crises, like up at La Loche, that You can help us not only to mourn and grieve for those people, but to find solutions within our nation, to find ways that the Aboriginals who feel cast out and rejected, all those who feel bullied and left alone, might find comfort, might find a place of home and welcome, might find a place of belonging. We pray for the victims there as well, that they will find healing, mercy, and be able to offer forgiveness. God, we pray that You help us when we ourselves get into trouble, and especially that You prevent us from being the source of trouble, that You help us to think before we speak, that You give us the wisdom to know what to do when a crisis comes up, that You even help us to stay quiet and calm and to receive help when we need it. Lord, we offer You these prayers in the name of the One who taught us to pray, and we share His prayer together now. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. Thy kingdom come,
Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Please rise for a benediction. Now may the love of God, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, and the presence of Jesus himself be with you this day and forevermore. Excuse me. And together we say, Amen.